cancer is the second most common cancer for women in India. But unfortunately, 70 to 80% of women are diagnosed at an advanced stage. And that makes treatment very ineffective. Cure rates are suboptimal. And quality of life of these patients after treatment is poor. We all know that the cause of cervical cancer is HPV infection. You know, infection with human papillomavirus, especially type 16 and 18. But not all women who are infected with HPV are likely to develop cervical cancer. So for every 10 lakh or 1 million infected women, 1 lakh will develop cervical abnormality. That's 10% of them, out of which 0.8% will develop a carcinoma in situ if it is untreated. And if that is also untreated, eventually only 1600 women will develop cervical cancer. But unfortunately, with every million, that means almost 90 to 95% of the female population is essentially exposed to HPV at some point of time or the other. So this makes the overall caseload of new cases in India per year roughly about 1,20,000. And every year we have about 70,000 deaths because of cervical cancer. I think, you know, you all are aware of the symptoms. You know, most commonly the patient will present to you with abnormal vaginal bleeding. Either it will be a postmenopausal bleeding, okay, or it could be a premenopausal patient who has irregular bleeding or postcoital bleeding. Sometimes they also do come with abnormal vaginal discharge. This is particularly seen in women who have a large cervical growth and that gets infected and they come to you with leucorrhea. They can also come with pain and limb swelling, which are more of symptoms of an advanced cervical cancer. And the same holds true for urinary or rectal symptoms, which you see in advanced cervical cancer. I think your examination is probably the most important aspect of evaluating patients for cervical cancer. And I think this is something which I have to highlight again and again. Apart from your regular examination, in your general examination, these are the three things that you need to look at. One is edema of the feet, because edema of the feet indicates that the disease has progressed to the lymph nodes and is quite advanced, so that the lymphatic channels are blocked. Second thing is you need to examine the lymph nodes, both the supraclavicular as well as the groin. And last but not the least is look for pallor, because majority of the patients of cervical cancer, they bleed over a period of time and eventually develop anemia that can reduce the effectiveness of the treatment, even if they are going for radiation or for surgery. Then the next part of your examination would be to go ahead and do a local examination. Because as you know, HPV can not only infect the cervix, but it can also infect the vulva and vagina. And these patients are very prone for having multifocal tumors. So it's very vital to have a look at the labia as well as the vagina. Then you go ahead and do a per-speculum examination. Now, on per-speculum examination, either you can see a large cauliflower-like growth, or you can see an ulcer, or you can see something like a very bad kind of erosion which bleeds on touch. You also have a look at the fornices, all the four fornices, anterior, posterior, and both lateral fornices. And you also have a look at the vaginal wall, whether there is any growth extension onto the vaginal wall. Then the important part, which essentially decides the staging of the patient, is per vaginal and per rectal examination, where you evaluate the size of the tumor, you evaluate the extension of growth by moving your fingers all around the cervix, you evaluate the mobility of the uterus, because if it's a fixed uterus, it indicates that the tumor has grown beyond the uterus and has infiltrated the paracervical and uterosacral ligament. And you also have a look at whether the growth has infiltrated either the bladder or the rectum. And now this has only per vaginal examination may not give you all kind of information. So it always has to be combined with per rectal examination. Now, this part of examination, you know, every patient may not allow you a detailed examination. Some patients are apprehensive, some are non-cooperative. Sometimes the vagina is too tight, sometimes the bleeding is more. So you may not have an adequate evaluation only without anesthesia. So if the patient, you feel that the examination is inadequate without anesthesia, I think it's advisable to examine these patients under anesthesia, because your clinical examination more or less decides how you are going to manage these patients further. And all the information that you get on these examinations is an absolute must. So if your examination is unsatisfactory, you should strongly consider examining these patients under anesthesia. Now, cervical cancer staging, you know, there have been major changes which has happened in cervical cancer staging. When the cervical cancer staging was updated in 2018, till 2018, cervical cancer was always a clinically staged disease. So you don't, the FIGO never asked you to do any kind of imaging unless required to stage a cervical cancer, because this is the disease of countries which have poor health infrastructure. And if you incorporate, extensive imaging into the staging, FIGO believed that the patients may not be adequately staged. So till 2018, cervical cancer staging was always clinical. But now, there have been changes which are recommended. Initially, if you know, there were only two stages, stage 1A and stage 1B1 and 1B2. Where if the tumor was less than 4 cm, it was 1B1. If it was more than 4 cm, it was 1B2. Now, it has been changed. It has been divided into 1B1, 1B2 and 1B3. So, if it is less than 2 cm, it is 1B1. If it is 2 to 4 cm, it is 1B2. And if it is more than 4 cm, it is now classified as 1B3. So, this is one of the major changes that has happened in the system. The other major change that you all need to understand is the inclusion of lymph nodes in evaluation of cervical cancer. For all the previous cervical cancer staging, lymph node status was never included in cervical cancer staging. But now it has been included, and if pelvic lymph node metastasis is there, it is staged as stage 3C1. If there is paraaortic metastasis, it is staged as stage 3C2. Now, this is something which has caused a lot of controversy. You know, people, how do you evaluate the lymph nodes? Is it really mandatory to remove the lymph node? But FIGO has been very clear now that evaluation of the lymph node has to be a part of cervical cancer staging. So how do you implement this in your practice? Because that is something that you need to know. So clinical examination remains exactly the same as I discussed with you. When the resources permit, imaging evaluation has to be added to evaluate the local spread and the nodal status. So you need, apart, because your clinical examination has been proved to be inaccurate in about 30% of patients. So in 30% cases, you are essentially understaging the patient who were overstaged after doing an imaging. So FIGO has allowed now to incorporate imaging. The imaging could be either an ultrasonography, it could be a CT scan, it could be MRI, or it could be a PET scan. Our policy at our hospital is, if we are looking for local spread, we always do a MRI. MRI is based in terms of evaluating the size of the tumor, also whether it has spread to the parametrium or not. But if it is nodal metastasis that you are looking at, PET CT scan is probably the best imaging modality that is available, with a false negative rate of only 4 to 14%. So the confusion is, what is best? Because you can't ask every patient to undergo MRI and then undergo a PET CT. So in my view, you should do an MRI that is best. If the MRI is suggestive of any enlarged lymph node, rather than doing a PET CT scan, we should do a FNAC or biopsy from the nodes to confirm whether the disease has gone to the nodes. And it has also included the paraaortic nodal assessment. So initially, we were always looking at pelvic nodes for cervical cancer, but now you also have to have a look at the paraaortic node. So in a nutshell, you do a clinical examination. If the patient is affording, if the resources are available, get an MRI abdomen and pelvis with contrast. If MRI is not available, do a CT scan. And if there are enlarged lymph nodes on MRI or on a CT scan, do an FNAC or a biopsy from the nodes to confirm whether the enlargement of the nodes is because of metastasis from the cancer or it is because of some of the other reasons like infections or tuberculosis, which is quite common in India. So to take home the message, and what FIGO, these are the recommendations of FIGO. Whenever you are in doubt whether it is stage 3C or not, always assign lower staging to patient. That is the recommendation of FIGO. Imaging and pathology are allowed to be incorporated in staging, as I discussed with you. Now, the only thing that when you stage, you have to mention whether you have used imaging, if you have used what kind of image you used, and pathology, if you have used, you have to mention that, okay, this is stage 3C1 and it was pathologically confirmed either doing an FNC or biopsy from the lymph nodes. So whenever we get a patient, you know, of cervical cancer, you know, there are three parts of pre-treatment evaluation. One is established tissue diagnosis. Now, we see many times patients who have cytology, which is suggestive of squamous carcinoma, but only cytology suggestive of squamous carcinoma is not adequate. All patients of any cancer, but especially cervical cancer, prior to starting treatment, you need a biopsy to be done. The second thing is staging of the disease. As I said, the staging of the disease is essentially clinical, but with current thing, you also have to incorporate imaging as well as FNAC if required in order to reach a correct staging of the disease. Then once you are done with this, there is always a question, should we be doing an IVP? Should we be doing a cystoscopy or a sigmoidoscopy? I don't think you require to do that unless you are suspecting a bladder or a rectum involvement on your clinical examination or on MRI. And the last thing is hematological investigation, which is a part and parcel of any malignancy treatment, because you need to know how the patient's kidney function, liver functions, hemoglobin, platelets, and WBC and rest of the things are. So again, you know, as I said, if you are looking at parametrium or the spread of the disease surrounding the uterus, MRI is probably the best thing. If you don't have MRI, you are only looking at scan, or you are only looking at lymph node, a PET CT scan is probably the best. But as a rule of thumb for cervical cancer, always remember MRI is probably and should be the investigation of choice in order to evaluate the local spread as well as the lymph node. Now, coming to the cervical cancer histology, you know, you all know that squamous carcinoma is probably the most common cervical cancer, which is seen in about 80 to 90% of patients, followed by adenocarcinoma, followed by small cell and verrucous carcinomas, which are seen in very small proportion of patients. When you are talking of cervical cancer now, you know, you always have to divide cervical cancer into early cervical cancer and advanced cervical cancer. Now, early cervical cancer are cervical cancers which have superficial invasion like stage 1A1 and 1A2. I'm sorry, I think I just clinical staging. So, 1A2 essentially based on this diagnosis is always based on colposcopy guided biopsy. This is the diagnosis where the lesion is not visible on the cervix, but the patient has an abnormal pap smear. In view of abnormal pap smear, she undergoes a colposcopy and a guided biopsy. The 1A stage is essentially called as microinvasive cervical cancer, where the cervical cancer is not visible to a naked eye, but it is only visible under the microscope. 1B classification is quite clear, 1B1, 1B2, 1B3, based on the size of the tumor. And stage 2A, 2 is divided into 2A1, where the growth is involving the upper third of the vagina, but it is less than 4 centimeters. And 2A2, when the growth is involving the vagina, upper two-third of vagina, but the size of tumor is more than 4 centimeters. Stage 2B is parametrial involvement, but not up to pelvic wall. Stage 3A is involvement of the lower third of vagina. Stage 3B is you have a hydronephrotic or a non-functioning kidney. And stage 3C is involvement either of the lymph nodes or pelvic wall. Stage is if it is spread to bladder, rectum, it is stage 4A. If it is spread to lungs, liver, or any distant organ or peritoneal cavity organs, it is staged as stage 4B. So once you are sure with that, now you can see that early cervical cancer is 1A1, 1A2, which is essentially a microinvasive cervical cancer, or an early invasive cervical cancer, what we call as stage 1B and stage 2A1. And advanced are either a locally advanced cervical cancer or a metastatic cervical cancer, which you see. Now, what is early cervical cancer? Why do you need to know? Because these are essentially patients who are curable with surgery. If you see the survival rates in the slide down, for stage 1A1 and 1A2, the survival or the cure rates are almost 97%. It drops to 84% 62% for stage 1B and it drops to 66% for stage 2. So as you move ahead in staging, the survival dramatically drops. So early invasive cervical cancer is probably the most treatable cervical cancer. Now, how do you treat these patients? These are, as I said, these patients are essentially clinically asymptomatic and their diagnosis is only based after you evaluate an abnormal pap smear and then you perform either a loop electrosurgical excision or a cone biopsy. And the management is essentially dependent on a variety of factors. But the most important factors are depth of invasion, lymphvascular space invasion, and the status of the margin. These three things, you keep a watch on this as we move on to further slide. Now, let us talk about depth of invasion. If you see, if the depth of invasion is less than 1%, the death rate is 0.1%. Only 0.1% of patients would die. If the depth of infiltration is 1 to 3 millimeters, the recurrence rate is only 2% and the dying because of disease is 0.5%. But as you move from 3 to 5 millimeters, you can see the death rate go up 6 times and it moves on to 3%. So this is why depth of infiltration is important in terms of when you are deciding a treatment for microinvasive cervical cancer. Now the same thing applies to lymphvascular space invasion. If you see, if the lymphvascular space invasion is positive, the recurrence rate is 5%. If the lymphvascular space invasion is negative in stage 1A1, where the depth of infiltration is less than 3 millimeters, the risk of lymph node metastasis is 0.6%. Now for stage 1A2, if you have a lymphvascular space invasion positive, the recurrence rate is almost 18%. So this is why depth of infiltration and lymphvascular space invasion are very vital in decision making for early invasive or a microinvasive cervical cancer. Now, this is a very complicated chart, but I will make it very clear for you. 1A1 is essentially a microinvasive cancer with depth of infiltration less than 3 centimeters, less than 3 millimeters. Now, the most important question in these patients is when the mode of biopsy, either you have done a cone biopsy or a leaf, and you have to look at the margins. If the margins are negative, okay, on the cone biopsy, then you ask the patient whether she wants fertility preservation or not. If the fertility preservation is required, you go ahead with cone biopsy. If fertility is not required, you go ahead and do a simple hysterectomy. You don't require a radical hysterectomy or a Verdun's hysterectomy for a microinvasive cervical cancer. Correct? Now, if the patient's lymphvascular space invasion is positive, as I said, when the lymphvascular space invasion is positive, the risk of lymph node metastasis is very high. In those patients, you require what we call as a radical hysterectomy with bilateral pelvic lymph node dissection. So it's very clear for 1A1 or 1A2, if the fertility is required, in 1A1, only cone biopsy is sufficient. But if any adverse prognostic factor in terms of depth of infiltration or in terms of lymphvascular space invasion, patient requires what we call as a type 2 radical hysterectomy or Verdun's hysterectomy with bilateral pelvic lymph node dissection. So this chart is something that you need to remember in order to decide what kind of advice to these patients. Coming to the next stage, what we call as early invasive cervical cancer. Now in these patients, the tumor is visible on the cervix and the diagnosis is made just by taking a piece of tissue from a grossly abnormal growth that is seen on the cervix. Now here you have two options of treatment. Either you go ahead with surgery or you go ahead with radiation therapy. Now both these treatment options are providing you equally good results in terms of survival and in terms of recurrence rate. Then how do you decide? Because this has been proved. See, what we call as a randomized controlled trial. So randomized controlled trials is basically what we call as a level one evidence. And when they compared, say, 343 patients, half of them received surgery and half of them received radiation therapy in early cervical cancer, there was absolutely no difference in terms of disease-free survival or in terms of overall survival. So the outcome of these two treatments are exactly the same. So how do you decide whether you go ahead with surgery or whether you need to go ahead with radiation therapy? And there are a variety of things that come into picture. One is age of the patient. So younger the patient, the better, their outcomes with surgery. then if the patient has a lot of medical comorbidities, if she is very obese, diabetic, hypertensive, cardiac disease, high risk for surgery, I think those patients would go for radiation therapy. Now, if imaging shows lymph nodes are enlarged, probably then these patients are better off with radiation therapy. Available expertise, you know, some centers have surgeons available, some centers have radiation oncologists available. So it depends on what kind of treatment that is available at your center. And last but not the least is patient's desire. You know, many times the patients decide, you know, you give them the option and then decide, okay, doc, I want to go ahead with surgery for cervical cancer, and then we go ahead with surgery. There are some patients who are very scared of surgery and say, doctor, I don't want surgery. We go ahead with radiation therapy. But in terms of choice, if I have to decide in my practice, young patients, no medical comorbidities, imaging is favorable, I would prefer to operate on these patients. Now, this is a slide. This is not sure about the entire history of how radical hysterectomy has evolved. So the first person to do radical hysterectomy was Clark in 1895. Verdansh was actually his student. So he modified the hysterectomy where he decided removal of not only the uterus but the surrounding tissue. And Verdansh advocated that you only remove enlarged lymph nodes. Okay. Then comes Shorter. He said, so why are you doing it abdominally when I can remove a radical vaginal hysterectomy vaginally? So he was the one who sort of started a radical vaginal hysterectomy revolution. Then there came a Japanese surgeon. Now, let me tell you, Japanese are some of the best onco surgeons that you will see in the world. So, Okabayashi was the one who said there are a lot of problems we see after radical hysterectomy in terms of bladder dysfunction. So, he recommended the treatment of nerve-sparing radical hysterectomy, where you preserve the nerve supply to the bladder. But the most important modification came by Miggs. You know, in 1944, he was Verdansh's student. And Miggs said, okay, rather than removing only the enlarged lymph node, let us remove the entire chain of lymph node. So that gave to the term of systematic lymphadenectomy, where you remove all the lymph nodes that are present in the pelvis so that you can diagnose and treat this patient. There is an Indian contribution to it, Dr. Mitra from Bengal. So when Shorta said, Shorta never addressed the lymph nodes. So the lymph nodes were left as it is. He only did a radical vaginal hysterectomy. But Dr. Mitra recommended, apart from radical hysterectomy, he started doing extraperitoneal pelvic lymphadenectomy or extraperitoneal removal of the pelvic lymph node. Then the major breakthrough came in 1987 when D'Argent, a French surgeon, suggested a surgery called as radical trachelectomy, which is a fertility preserving surgery where you don't remove the uterus, you only remove the cervix and then anastomose the remaining part of the uterus to the vagina so the patient's fertility is preserved. Then came the laparoscopic revolution. The laparoscopic radical hysterectomy first was done in 1989 and lastly the robotic radical hysterectomy first it was done in 2006. So this is how surgery for cervical cancer has evolved over last 120 years. So these are sort of major landmarks, you know, how surgery evolved for cervical cancer over past almost 120 years. Now, this is what is called as the radical hysterectomy specimen. On the right hand side, you can see the uterus, both the ovaries, but what you see lateral to the cervix is the parametrium, and that is a radical hysterectomy. So when you are talking about radical hysterectomy, it's not only about removal of the uterus, but removal of the parametrium or the surrounding tissues of the cervix right up to the pelvic wall. The logic behind this is the tumor will infiltrate the cervix and grow laterally. So it will grow into the parametrium or the McIndroll's ligament as we call it, or it can go posteriorly into the uterosacral ligament. So whenever you are talking about radical hysterectomy, there are two parts of radical hysterectomy. One is radical removal of the uterus, cervix and the surrounding tissue. And second thing on the right, on the left hand side, the figure is a pelvic lymphadenectomy, where you remove all the lymph nodes in the pelvis along with the removal of the uterus. This is what we call as a type 3 radical hysterectomy. So this is again two parts, as I discussed, radical resection of parametrium and pelvic lymphadenectomy. Now, there are five different types of radical hysterectomy. So, I will just touch them briefly. Type 1 is a simple hysterectomy that we all the time, even for benign conditions like fibroids or endometriosis, where you don't touch anything but the uterus. Type 2 is the modified radical hysterectomy, where you remove the medial 50% of the uterosacrals and the McIndoe's ligament. And the uterine vessels are divided medial to the ureter. I'll explain you this. Type 3 is the classical Verdamsnig operation, which is probably the most commonly done type of radical hysterectomy for cervical cancer, where you dissect the ureter completely up to its entry into the bladder. You remove the parametrium or the uterosacrals right up to the pelvic wall and the uterosacrals up to the sacrum, and then you divide the uterine artery at its origin. So this ensures that you remove the parametrium completely, as well as you remove the lymph nodes completely. Then type 4 and 5 are something that you use for more advanced cervical cancer. Nowadays, nobody does type 4 and type 5 radical hysterectomy. Now, it is important to understand the difference in surgeries for benign conditions and malignant or cancerous condition. Now, for all benign conditions, your approach to the anatomy is always intraperitoneal. So, you are doing a hysterectomy for a fibroid uterus. You just open the peritoneum. You don't bother where are the ureters, unless it is mandatory, not in all cases. And you remove the uterus and the surgery is done. Malignancy or cancer surgeries, be it cervical cancer, be it ovarian cancer, be it endometrial cancer, it always begins in the retroperitoneum. So the whole idea is you first identify the structures that you want to save, important structures like ureter and the blood vessels, and then you proceed ahead with your surgery. Now, retroperitoneal anatomy is about four things. Vessels, so you have artery and veins. You have nerves, motor and visceral nerves. For radical hysterectomy, there are three different spaces that you need to dissect. The pararectal space, the paravesical space and the prerectal space. And you also have to dissect the viscera, right? You have to dissect the ureter, you have to dissect the bladder and you have to dissect the rectum. So if you ask me which is the most complete pelvic surgery, it has to be the radical hysterectomy, because you are essentially dissecting everything that is there in the pelvis. You are dissecting the artery, you are dissecting the ureter, you are dissecting the bladder, you are creating the spaces, and you are removing the uterus with its attachment without damaging any of these structures. So that's why I consider if you know how to do, or if you have seen a radical hysterectomy, you will never be scared of ureter or any anatomical changes that happen in pelvis. Now, these are the steps in radical hysterectomy. So you first open the abdomen. Now, I'm just talking about conventional surgery. We'll come to minimal access surgery a little later. The first thing I do is, first I palpate the upper abdomen. Okay, I palpate the paraortic nodes, and I also have a look at the liver and the rest of the abdominal organ. If any of these are affected, there is no point in doing radical hysterectomy. So you just back out. There is no point, because the disease has gone beyond the control of that. Disease has gone where you cannot control it by surgery. Then the next thing we do is do a classical pelvic lymphadenectomy, where you remove the entire set of pelvic lymph nodes. The third thing is you develop pelvic spaces, the pararectal, paravesical and prerectal space. Then you ligate the uterine vessels at its origin. Then you do the complete ureteric dissection right up to its entry into the bladder wall. Then you resect the parametrium, that is the McIndoe's ligament and the uterosacral ligament. Lastly, you do the vaginal cuff excision and take out the specimen. So these are seven steps how you define or how you perform a radical hysterectomy or a Verdamsnig hysterectomy. Okay. Now, this is most important thing to know is about pelvic lymphadenectomy. I will show you the boundaries how pelvic lymphadenectomy is done, but it is probably the most important prognostic factor. So you have same patient, a stage 1B patient with positive lymph nodes, the survival is only 50%. But if the lymph nodes are negative, the survival is 90%. So that's how important lymph nodes are in terms of prognosticating the disease. And what all you remove? You remove the common iliac lymph nodes, you remove the external iliac lymph nodes, you remove the internal iliac lymph nodes, you remove the obturator lymph nodes, and you remove the presacral lymph nodes. So these are the five group of lymph nodes that you need to remove in a radical hysterectomy for cervical cancer. Now, these are the margins of this lymph node dissection. So I am starting from you. We will go clockwise. Okay. So the first thing is the left corner is the proximal margin. The proximal margin, you can see I have marked the arrow for the ureter. The proximal margin is where the ureter is crossing the common iliac artery. Did you all see it? That's the proximal margin. Now, the lateral margin is the genitofemoral nerve. I don't think you can see it because there are photographs on that side. The distal margin is the circumflex iliac vein. Again, I have highlighted the vein. So, when you are going towards the groin, that's where you stop. The inferior margin is the lateral pelvic wall. You can see the obturator nerve, and just lateral to that is the lateral pelvic wall. And the medial margin is internal iliac vein and artery. Here you can see the external iliac vein above and the internal iliac vein going down below. So the proximal margin is where the ureter crosses. Lateral margin is genitofemoral nerve. Inferior margin is lateral pelvic wall. Distal margin is circumflex iliac vein. And medial margin is internal iliac vein and artery. So this is how a lymphadenectomy is performed. Now, retroperitoneal spaces, that's the next thing. So you have two major retroperitoneal spaces. This is the paravesical space on the left side. So it is bounded medially by the internal iliac artery, laterally by the external iliac artery and vein, and inferiorly you can see the levator ani muscle. So the levator ani muscle essentially forms the base of the paravesical space. The pararectal space, as the name suggests, it's the space laterally between the rectum and the ureter. So it's the space, where the medial boundary of pararectal space is bounded by rectum and lateral boundary is by ureter, and the inferior boundary is formed by the sacrum. So once you dissect these two spaces, then the next step is to identify the uterine artery and ligate the uterine artery at its origin. So that's the next step in a radical hysterectomy. Then you go ahead, you can see the ureter being held. You dissect the ureter all the way to its entry into the urinary bladder. Now, that is probably the most important step of a radical hysterectomy, and it also decides the outcome. So, particularly the complication like urinary fistula. So, if you don't do the ureteric dissection properly, you are most likely to have. And unless you dissect the ureter properly, you won't be able to take out. You can see the margins of resection. Here, the parametrium is resected at the lateral pelvic wall, okay? That is the lateral margin, and posteriorly, the uterosacral ligament is cut right at its insertion into the sacrum. So, unless you dissect the ureter, you won't be able to get these margins. And that's how, and the final part is the vaginal cuff excision. Whenever you are doing a radical hysterectomy, you at least need to remove about 1.5 to 2 centimeters of normal vagina in order that the patients, do not have a vault recurrence after surgery.
Sir?
Now,
hello? Sir, can you explain the margins again?
About this, vaginal margins you want?
About the previous one, the lymph node margins.
Yeah, I'm here.
Yes, sir.
So can everybody see?
Yes.
See, whenever you see, lymph node is always a template, okay? So, you start from above. So, if you can see the proximal margin, what you can see there is an inferior vena cava and aorta there. If you can appreciate that. Now, the proximal margin starts at the common iliac where the ureter crosses the common iliac artery. Okay. Is that clear?
Yes.
Okay. Then the distal margin, as you go along the vessels towards the thigh, this is the external iliac vein and this is the external iliac artery. And circumflex iliac vein is a branch of external iliac vein. So that is the inferior margin. That is the distal margin. The medial margin is, you can see the internal iliac artery which is being hooked with an instrument and the internal iliac vein. So you remove the entire group of lymph nodes from these areas in order to define a complete lymphadenectomy. Okay?
Yes, sir.
So after this, you know, then this is what is a radical hysterectomy. But as with everything, it has been evolutionized. So, you know, there is a surgery called radical trachelectomy. So patients, young patients with very early cervical cancer, you only remove the cervix in order to preserve their, fertility. Or you have moved on to something like a minimal invasive surgery, a nerve sparing radical hysterectomy, or a sentinel node mapping. All these things are done to reduce the morbidity that is associated with a radical surgery. And another thing that I think you need to know if you all have an exam going is that there is a new classification of radical hysterectomy. So there was an old classification which I suggested you. There is a new classification called as Q&M classification, that is known as Querlu and Monroe classification, which is where, because if you noted the initial thing did not have a nerve sparing as a part of it. Now this classification has a nerve sparing radical hysterectomy as a part of it. So instead of type 3, type C1 is something called as a nerve-sparing radical hysterectomy, where you preserve the nerve supply to the bladder, and then the rest of things are just the counterpart of type 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So the C1 is the only modification in the old classification. Instead of 1, 2, 3, they have given name as type A, type B, type C1, type C2, and type D. Okay, but by and large, the principle, the major difference between these two classification is inclusion of a nerve-sparing radical hysterectomy. That's it. Now, the other thing is about sentinel node mapping. I don't think, you know, at your level, you probably need to go, because this is not something a standard of care for cervical cancer. Because sentinel node, the principle is that you inject a dye into the tumor. And the first lymph node that lights up with the dye is essentially taken out. And if that lymph node is negative, we assume that the rest of the lymph nodes are absolutely negative. But I don't think, it is sensitive enough to be used as a routine. We use sentinel node biopsy only for tumors which are less than 2 centimeters. But apart from that, once the tumor is more than 2 centimeters, I don't think we use, because the sensitivity of the sentinel node biopsy for tumors which are more than 2 centimeters is very, very, very less. Okay. Now, this is another thing, you know, as I said, Dargent was one who said why all women with cervical cancer should undergo hysterectomy. Because we are essentially depriving them of their chance of being a mother. So he said there are young women whose tumor is less than 2 centimeters, who have squamous carcinoma, who have no lymph node metastasis on MRI, and there is no spread. These are the women where we should try a fertility preserving surgery. And what is that surgery? The tissue in that shaded line is the only tissue that is removed. So you remove the diseased part of the cervix with a small portion of the vagina, and then you can imagine you anastomose the upper part of the uterus with the vagina. So what happens is you are only removing the diseased cervix, keeping the uterus, and then these women are subjected to either an in vitro fertilization in order to conceive. And the only problem that is seen in these people is this patient is cervical incompetence. Okay, because, you know, so their recommendation is nowadays, if you are doing it in married women, you should put an intra-abdominal stitch at the time of surgery itself. Because these are women, because you are removing the cervix, there is no cervix. So obviously, majority of them would have a cervical incompetence and repeated miscarriages. So that is something of a problem in women with the radical trachelectomy. Now, as I said, the rate of preterm birth is very high as compared to general population in these patients. And it's mainly because of, removal of the entire portion of the cervix. Now, here is one case I just wanted to highlight, which we did. She was a 4-year-old girl, okay, with a clear cell carcinoma of the cervix, where we did a fertility preserving surgery for her. Because obviously at 4 years, you know, I was very hesitant, to remove her uterus and ovaries completely. So you can see this was the tumor. On the left-hand side is the MRI, the bladder, and you can see a large tumor there. This is the specimen of a radical trachelectomy. The third figure is the anastomosed uterus inside the abdomen. So it is something which is feasible, but the proportion of patients that we see who are fit to undergo a radical trachelectomy is very, very less. So the criteria are very strict. The tumor has to be less than 2 centimeters. It has to be a squamous carcinoma, and there has to be no spread outside the cervix, including the lymph node. Only if this is fine, then only you consider these women for a fertility preserving surgery, otherwise not. So this formulates only about 1% of our patients, you know, who come so early to us and who are young enough and who have not completed the family. So in your lifetime, maybe you will see 2 or 3 cases where you can actually perform a radical trachelectomy. But for those 2 or 3 patients, it's going to be a life-changing decision. So we ought to know, particularly when we are seeing young women with small cervical cancer, that there is a treatment option available where they can preserve their fertility. Now, this is something which is probably the most controversial topic today. You know, what is the role of minimal access surgery in cervical cancer, be it radical laparoscopic hysterectomy or be it a robotic radical hysterectomy? We all know the advantages of minimal invasive surgery in terms of blood loss, hospital stay, less morbidity, better quality of life, the cost is less. And we always thought that whether you do open surgery or laparoscopic surgery, the outcome of patients are same. Okay. And that was the assumption all the gynae oncologists across the world were having it. And they were using laparoscopic radical hysterectomies for cervical cancers, left, right, and center. Okay. Assuming that everything is all well and good, but that is not. Okay. There was a randomized trial, you know, known as LACC trial, okay, which compared women who underwent open radical hysterectomy versus who underwent a laparoscopic or a robotic radical hysterectomy, okay. And that was probably the best way to compare whether their outcomes are exactly the same or not. And their results have stunned the gynae oncology community, okay, because what they studied is overall survival. What was the pattern of recurrence of malignancy in these women? What was their quality of life? And what was the treatment associated morbidity? Okay, because these are the 4 parameters on which you will always test one treatment modality against the other. I won't go into the details of this. I will just highlight some of the important points. One is disease-free survival. Okay, disease-free survival, that means when a patient has a recurrence. Okay, so at 5 years, okay, 14% of patients with minimal invasive surgery had recurrence, okay, versus only 3% women with open surgery for cervical cancer had a recurrence. So significantly lesser women with open surgery had recurrence for cervical cancer as compared to laparoscopic surgery. One. Second thing is overall survival. When they compared survival at 5 years, 99% of women with open surgery were alive as compared to 93% with minimal access surgery, be it laparoscopy or be it robotic. And most importantly is the recurrence rate. Okay, at 5 years, the recurrence rate were 4.4% with laparoscopy, only 0.6% with open surgery. So all these results go overwhelmingly in favor of abandoning minimal access surgery for cervical cancer. Because in America, they have stopped doing minimal access surgery for cervical cancer. Because any patient, you do a laparoscopic surgery and she has a recurrence and she gets her hand on this paper and she will come and sue you saying, "Doctor, you have no business to do this surgery for me." Or at least your job is at least to tell them that you may have a higher risk of recurrence. And if they still opt for laparoscopic surgery, so be it. But that has to be an informed decision by the patient. Again, recurrence rate 8.4% versus 2.2%. So on all fronts, you know, the minimal access surgery has been found inferior for cervical cancer as compared to conventional open surgery. So in our practice, we have stopped. Okay, we don't offer any minimal access surgery for cervical cancer, and that has to be the norm till there are some more trials which are going on across the world. If they come up with some better evidence, definitely we will change our practice. But as of today, because, you know, and the other thing, you know, that we need to tell this patient, there are a lot of papers which have come after this paper stating that minimal access surgery is inferior, you know, to see. Because if you see, this is how you will have to counsel the patient, okay? There is a 4 times more risk of recurrence after laparoscopic surgery. There is a 6 times more risk of you dying because of the disease if you do laparoscopic surgery. There is no difference in complication rate. There is no difference in terms of short-term and long-term morbidity, whether you do open surgery or laparoscopic surgery. And there is no difference in quality of life after 1 week. So it is matter of only 1 week. Now, only for improved quality of life for 1 week, are we going to subject our patients to 4 times more risk of disease and 6 times more risk of dying because of the disease? I think the answer is very clear. As of today, so anybody asks you in exams, you have every right to say that laparoscopic surgery should not be done for cervical cancer. Now, most of the people, you know, may not be aware of the evidence, and people shrug off, you know, no, those Westerners don't know how to treat cervical cancer. But in my view, you either create evidence or you follow evidence. Okay, you can't criticize evidence. Okay, so either we create a data from Indian subset, okay, our outcomes are this, we still, till the time we have a better data, this has to be the standard of care. And in my view, currently, there is no role for minimal access surgery, be it laparoscopy or robotic surgery, for cervical cancer. And that's what I want to convey to all of you. Okay, this is something that you need to know. And as I said, it is just like this corona situation. Every day, new evidence comes, and we may change our treatment protocol based on that. But as of today, the evidence suggests that you should not be doing a laparoscopic surgery for cervical cancer. Now, coming to the next part is the complications of this surgery, you know, of radical hysterectomy. So it could be a vessel injury, it could be a ureter or bladder injury, it could be a nerve injury, it could be a rectal injury, or it could be bleeding. Okay, one of these things are likely to happen. The risk of these complications are very less. You know, the only significant complication is bladder dysfunction. You know, patients have voiding difficulties because you are essentially cutting all the nerve supply of the bladder. Okay, so that is why the nerve-sparing radical hysterectomy has come into picture, to avoid this complication. Ureteric fistulas are seen in less than 1% of patients. But the thing is, for all patients whom you are doing Vardhan, you need to counsel them about urinary fistulas, because one, this is a very distressing symptom for the patient. Okay, and two, this is a kind of symptom where they may require an additional surgery to correct it. Okay, so this is something that all your patients should be aware of. Lymphoceles, whenever you remove lymph node, there is always a small collection which is seen in about 10 to 18%. But lymphocytes that require treatment are seen in less than 2%. Infection can be there, or deep vein thrombosis. So all these patients have to be on DVT prophylaxis when you are operating on them. Okay, now urinary leak. This is something that I would like, you know, to understand. Urinary fistula. Now this is the same that you can even, you know, follow. Say we can even get a urinary fistula after a benign hysterectomy. Say you are doing it for a cervical fibroid, or you are doing it for endometriosis, there can be a ureteric injury, either because of cautery while you are doing laparoscopy, or you can cut it, and there can be a lot of problems. So majority of the times, the patient will come to you with some fluid leaking out through the vagina, because that's where you diagnose. Okay, the first thing that you need to do is do an examination, obviously, and the important investigation is to do a CT urography, or CT IVP, as we call it. Then you confirm whether it's a uretrovaginal fistula, because it could also be a vesicovaginal fistula. So you need to know that. Then if it's a uretrovaginal fistula, get the urologist on board and try to pass a DJ stent. Okay, you will be able to pass a DJ stent in only about 20 to 30% of patients. Okay, but in those 20 to 30%, once you pass a DJ stent, your job is essentially done, because the fistula will heal over the DJ stent, and you won't require any other surgery. So if the DJ stent is possible, pass the DJ stent and wait for 3 to 6 weeks. If it is not possible, you obviously will have to go ahead and do a fistula repair, a uretrovaginal fistula repair, or a vesicovaginal fistula repair, based on what kind of condition. So here is one of my patients who had a fistula, okay, after a radical hysterectomy. You can see the IVP on the left hand side, and you can see at close to the bladder there is a big leak of urine into the vagina. And in this case, fortunately, we were able to negotiate a DJ stent. We passed the DJ stent and the fistula healed over the DJ stent. But you may not be lucky in each and every case. And so in some cases, you may have to open and do a fistula repair. Now, this is probably, I think I have another 5 minutes. Yeah?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yeah. So this is probably the important part that I want. See, majority of the time we feel we have done a Verdun's hysterectomy and our job is done. The answer is no. The most important part is to evaluate whatever you remove, goes for a biopsy, and then you evaluate the biopsy report. Okay? And there are multiple factors that you need to have a look in terms of size, what is the depth of invasion, lymphovascular space invasion, parametrial margins, vaginal margins, and the lymph node involvement. And based on this, the patients are divided into low risk, intermediate risk, and high risk. So in low risk patients, you don't need any further treatment. Intermediate risk patients are patients who have deep infiltration of the tumor, or the tumor size is more than 4 centimeters. They require only radiation after surgery. Okay. High risk patients are patients where the lymph nodes are positive, whether the vaginal cut margin is positive or the parametrium is positive. These patients require, in addition to radiation, a chemotherapy along with radiation. Okay. Now, Dr. Pranav is going to talk, so I think he will cover about this aspect. But the important part is to evaluate the histopathology report and decide whether your patient requires any further treatment or not. That is something that we should not ignore, because sometimes we see patients who have undergone a surgery and nobody has bothered to have a look at their biopsy report, and they eventually came back to us with recurrence because that lady required radiation after surgery, but she did not receive. So this is something. So your treatment ends when you evaluate the histopathology report. So either tell the patient, okay, you need to go home, or refer the patient to a radiation oncologist. That's where your role as a gynecologist or gyne oncologist end. And then the patient, after completing the treatment, will come back to you for follow-up. Now, As a surgeon, I think there are significant advantages of surgery. Okay, in terms of there is a shorter treatment time. You can save the ovaries. You can retain the vaginal function, because after radiation, the vagina becomes very narrow and stenosed, and sexual intercourse can become a problem. You can have an accurate assessment of the disease, and sometimes the patients are very happy with the concept that the cancerous organ is out of their body. Okay, I think that's something that gives them an immense psychological benefit. But as I said, this treatment, we decide, based on patient to patient, what is the most optimum treatment for a patient. But early stage cervical cancer, medically fit patients, young patients, I definitely would offer them surgery over radiation therapy. So to conclude, I think, cervical cancer, the most important part is being aware of the diagnosis. Most importantly, always diagnose with a biopsy. Don't, decide your treatment only on cytology. For superficial invasive cancer, that is stage 1A1 and 1A2, they are optimally treated with surgery. For stage 1B and stage 2A, results of surgery and radiation are equivalent. But as I said, young patient, fit patient, very less chances of having radiation after surgery. We would err on the side of surgery for these patients. We can do conservative surgery or radical trachelectomy for a very small select group of patients who are less than 2 centimeters, young, desirous of fertility, squamous carcinoma, and no spread. Okay. Minimal access surgery as of today has no role in treatment of cervical cancer. Sentinel node mapping can only be used in patients with tumor less than 2 centimeters. Otherwise, again, it has no role. For locally advanced cervical cancer, I think Dr. Pranav will cover, radical radiation plus concurrent chemotherapy is the treatment of choice. Okay, I think I thank you all. I think I took a lot of your time. If you have any questions, I will be happy to answer.
Yes, sir. The questions?
Yeah.
So difference between the extrafacial and intrafacial hysterectomy.
See, extrafacial hysterectomy is basically where you remove the pubovesical cervical fascia. Okay. So there is a fascia which runs from the uterus, cervix, and it overlies the bladder. Now, normally to do an intrafacial hysterectomy, you actually have to incise that fascia and go inside the fascia. Okay. So normally the hysterectomy that we do, we never dissect those fascia. So all the hysterectomies that we do are essentially extrafacial. But for intrafacial hysterectomy, after you dissect the bladder, you actually have to take a small cut on the cervix, identify the fascia, and go inside that fascia.
So next question, so treatment of the post-hysterectomy hemorrhage.
It depends on what kind of hemorrhage you have. Okay. Now, there can be, if it's an immediate post-op, so you have immediate post-operative hemorrhage and secondary hemorrhages, which are because of infection. Now, if it's an immediate post-operative hemorrhage, that most often than not, it is because of either slipping of a ligature or, you know, the vaginal angle is strong. Most of the times, it's because the uterine artery or the ovarian artery slipped. And you just have to go inside, identify the bleeder, take it and leave it at that. The difficult problem is when you have patient who come to you with bleeding after 8 days of surgery. Okay. Now, in this patient, majority of the times is bleeding because of infection, and then there is sloughing of tissue and that causes the bleeding. Okay. Now, the most important part in these patients is to do a per speculum examination. If the bleeder is from the vagina, you can identify and you can cauterize it or you can pack the vagina. The problem is if the bleeding is coming from abdomen, okay, or if it is abdominal bleeding which is trickling through the vagina, then the best thing would be either to do a CT angio and do an angioembolization. That is probably the best treatment, okay, because that is least invasive. But if that is not possible, then you just have to go in and ligate the internal iliac artery.
Okay,
sir.
Sir, explain the total mesocervical excision.
See, total mesocervical excision is something has been used as a concept like what we use for total mesorectal. So, what they suggested is that, you know, you remove not only the cervix, but the embryological part from which the cervix is derived. So, it is essentially not only resecting this, but also removing a part of the mesorectum and also removing part of the bladder fish. But I don't think total sort of mesometrial, it is called a total mesometrial resection, is not an accepted treatment or not a desired treatment for cervical cancer.
Okay. So please tell first three most common causes of cancer in women in India and world respectively.
In India, it is breast, cervix and oral cavity, basically. Worldwide, it is breast, lung and colon.
Okay. And treatment of CA cervix in pregnancy?
Again, it depends on, there are two or three things that decide about treatment of. One is, what is the stage of the pregnancy? Okay, whether it's first trimester, second trimester or third trimester. That is one. And second thing is, what is the stage of the disease? Okay. Now, if it's a first trimester, I think it's no brainer. You have to terminate the pregnancy and go ahead with treatment. Okay. So if it, because you can't wait for 6 months or 7 months for treatment of cervical cancer, it cannot wait for that long. So if it's up to 20 weeks, okay, our idea is if it is operable, you go ahead with surgery with fetus in situ. Okay. Okay. You don't need, to remove the fetus out. Okay. So, you can remove, say if it's first trimester, then you can do a radical hysterectomy with the fetus in situ. But if it's second trimester, sometimes you may have to do a hysterotomy to take the fetus out and then go ahead with the radical hysterectomy. Okay. Now, if the patient requires radiation, whether to terminate pregnancy or not, that's the question. So, if it's for first trimester, you don't need to terminate pregnancy. The radiation itself will take care of the fetus. If it's second trimester, you need to terminate the pregnancy. The dilemma comes when the patient has 28 or say patient comes to you at 28 weeks with cervical cancer, then what to do? Then in those cases, I think you should wait for the fetus to mature. Okay, use all your methods to accelerate maturity of the fetus in terms of giving them steroids and whatnot. I am absolutely out of touch with obstetrics, but you know, and once the fetal lungs are mature, you deliver the fetus by cesarean section and then either do a radical hysterectomy at the same time, or if the patient requires radiation after the cesarean section 1 week, you refer the patient for radiation. But you are justified in waiting for 4 to 6 weeks for treatment in case if the fetus is an issue and if the fetus is going to be mature in that period of time. But beyond 4 to 6 weeks, it's not advised.
Okay. And what is the anterior vesicouterine and posterior vesicouterine ligament, as in what then?
As in anterior vesicouterine ligament is basically what I understand is the roof of the ureteric tunnel. Now, it's very difficult to explain. If I could have been able to show you a surgery, I would have been able to explain you. But if you know, the ureteric tunnel is like this, okay, if you can see. And the ureter is going through it like this. So the upper part or the roof of the tunnel is anterior vesicouterine ligament, basically. And the floor of that ureteric tunnel is the posterior vesicouterine ligament. And the lateral part of the tunnel is the lateral vesicouterine.
Okay. So what is selective lymphadenectomy?
There is nothing as selective lymphadenectomy. Selective lymphadenectomy is not to be used in cervical cancer, number one. But selective lymphadenectomy is the term you use when you only remove bulky or enlarged lymph node. And you don't do a systematic lymphadenectomy as to remove the entire chain of lymph nodes, irrespective of whether they are enlarged or not.
Okay. And is ureteric stenting is done prior to surgery?
No, it is not mandated. It is not recommended. In fact, it causes more problems if you do ureteric stenting prior to surgery. We do ureteric stenting. Say sometimes you do a surgery and you feel the ureteric supply is little compromised in one or two areas. Okay, or you might have dissected a bit more. Then you can put a stent post-operatively. Okay, immediately after the surgery. But pre-operative ureteric stenting to prevent ureteric injury is not recommended.
Okay. So one question is there, cone biopsy or radical trachelectomy? Cone biopsy versus radical trachelectomy for 1A case.
See, if it is 1A, one cone biopsy is sufficient. As long as I said, if the lymph vascular space invasion is negative. Okay, so what we are talking about, 1A1, where the depth of infiltration is less than 3 millimeters and lymph vascular space invasion is negative, a cone biopsy is sufficient. But if you are dealing with 1A1 with lymph vascular space invasion is positive, or if the depth of infiltration is more than 3 millimeters, cone biopsy alone is not sufficient. You need to do a trachelectomy with lymph node dissection. So whether to do cone biopsy or trachelectomy based on two factors, depth of infiltration, whether less than 3 millimeters or more than 3 millimeters, and two is lymph vascular space invasion, whether it is present or whether it is absent.
Okay. So parametrial invasion, if it's clinically free and MRI says it is involved, what to go with?
I think, you know, you have to go with what the MRI suggests more often than not. Okay. Because clinical exam, MRI is more sensitive and specific to detect parametrial extension than clinical examination. So if there is a doubt, I think you should go with what the MRI suggests.
Okay, so is vesicouterine ligament and bladder pillars are same?
Yes.
So we have answered most of the questions, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir, for this simplified lecture and your valuable.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, guys. Thank you. Thanks a lot for appearing. And thank you for giving me the opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Bye.
Thank you so much. Bye, sir. Good night.
Bye.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir, we can hear you, sir. Please share your screen.
Yes, I'm not here. I need to enlarge my screen.
So please share your screen. It is the option below. Share.
All right. All right. So you can see it?
Yes, sir. Just it is loading, sir.
All right.
Yes. So students, we have Dr. Pranav Chadha with us. He is a consultant in the Kokila Ben Dhirubhai Ambani Hospital, and he is a radiation oncologist. So yes, sir, you can start. Sir?
All right.
Yes, sir.
Hello. Hi. Good evening, everyone. My name is Pranav. So I'll be taking. Yes. Am I audible? Hello.
Yes, sir. Hello. So please share your. Please start.
All right. So my topic for today is radiation therapy in gynecological cancers. So, as we all know, radiation therapy was discovered with the discovery of X-rays, and Willem Röntgen discovered those X-rays. He actually named them, and the radiotherapy started off in the early 20th century with the use of radium and artificial radionuclei. So these two individuals are the pioneers: Willem Röntgen, who discovered the X-rays, and Madame Curie, who sort of used the radium. She also died of cancer because of the exposure to radium. Radiation therapy was and is and will be used for the treatment of various malignancies. In fact, virtually all the solid tumors. All right. So a couple of radiotherapy machines. Radiotherapy is administered employing sophisticated machines. It started off in 1951 with a telecobalt unit in Canada. And then the cobalt switched over to Betatron, linear accelerator, proton therapy, carbon therapy, and the list is endless. So it's a very highly technical and technological driven discipline. So this is how the cobalt has given way to linear accelerator. A linear accelerator is basically, in a sense, is a cathode ray tube, which sort of uses the cathode ray tube principle, in which the electrons strike the tungsten target, and though the tungsten target emits the X-rays, the patient is lying in sort of the linear accelerator is in the type of a gantry which rotates around the patient, and the patient is lying on the couch. Now we've added more to the linear accelerator with the use of imaging on the linear accelerator itself by the name of cone beam CT. The other aspect of radiotherapy is to deliver the radiation. So radiation can be delivered. The next slide actually says that the radiation can be delivered either employing a source which is either external or internal. So brachytherapy basically means giving radiation which is near to the tumor or inside the tumor. Teletherapy, tele means from distant, that are the external beam sources. So brachytherapy machines in which, now this is an actual specimen of the uterus in which is showing a tube, a radium tube, which is inserted into the uterus. This is how a brachytherapy machine looks, which has a radioactive source. It is a sealed source which goes via a tube into the cavity or into the tissue where we want to irradiate so as to kill the cancer. This is how it looks from the front. So as I said, teletherapy is from a source outside. Brachytherapy is a source which we place. Now there are other radioactive sources which can be used for the radiation that comes under the domain of now nuclear medicine. The difference between radiation therapy and nuclear medicine is that the nuclear medicine employs unsealed sources, whereas radiotherapy, you have to be the patient in isolation for some time. All right. So what is the goal of radiation therapy? It is to simple common sense. It is to maximize the tumor cell death while minimizing damage to the healthy cells. The goal hasn't changed. We're just improving our technology so as to make things better. And there is never any reason to give any dose to the uninvolved normal tissue. This would be logical sort of inference. An increase in the dose to tumor will definitely improve the local control and, in a surrogate manner, increase the survival for the patient. Achieving these objectives are self-evidently true and does not require a randomized prospective trials. External beam radiotherapy, the teletherapy. Now, we started off with a simple two-dimensional radiotherapy in which we were using X-rays. Earlier, we were just using skin markings. Then we came on the era of CT, computed tomography based planning, in which we were using 3D conformal therapy. There are a lot of technicalities involved in the planning in which we need to make first an immobilization device. We need to immobilize the patient first because the machine sees the patient as a fixed object. If the patient keeps on moving, then the machine will not adapt. However, this technology has also been sort of has come up in the recent, but from the conventional point of view, we need to fix and to keep the patient set up in the most reproducible manner. Simulators. First, we need to do planning on the simulators in which we can put up a rough plan and then work on it so as to improve it and then finally give the most refined plan for the patient. Therefore, we have a 2D simulator. This is now more of a thing of the past. Now we've got a CT simulator, we've got an MRI simulator, and we also use PET CT, especially wherever we are re-irradiating. So radiation is not just that it can be given once, it can be given twice or thrice, depending upon certain parameters that we need to see and the certain time periods compared or corresponding to the primary irradiation. All right. So things have improved. Now, this is just a technological paradigm in the radiation, which is known intensity modulated radiotherapy, which is actually sort of a mathematical model in which we can fix our radiation and minimize the toxicity. Again, the goal remains the same. There are a lot of technical things which keep on coming so as to reduce the dose to the normal uninvolved tissue. All right. So as I said, IMRT, intensity modulated radiotherapy, it conforms to the dose of the shape of the target in 3D, sparing the normal tissues, employing multi-leaf collimators, which are part of the linear accelerator and a computerized control. There are two types of IMRT. One is a static IMRT and the other is a volumetric modulated arc therapy. So this is how a dose distribution looks. Now, I just wish to impress upon you, this is how the IMRT dose looks, as you can see. So this green, in case of cervix, we are treating sort of the entire bowel. And this is as per the conventional, the old conventional style of radiation therapy. So with IMRT, we can better spare the bowel, keeping the dose limited to the lymph nodes and the cervical primary when we are sort of dealing with the cervical cancer. And we've got results to prove it that the GI toxicity, that is the gastrointestinal toxicity, is less in IMRT. It has been proven. The chronic. So what happens after radiation therapy? There are two types of effects. One is during the radiation and what happens after the radiation. So we don't want the patient to land up in chronic GI toxicity. It's similar to surgery, that once a surgery happens, you might notice, especially in abdominal surgeries, that you might notice adhesions, you might notice some sort of a subacute intestinal obstruction. The same thing more or less applies to radiation, but with a strict computer control, we can limit those doses as sort of analogous to a robotic surgical option in your domain. Now, since we are dealing with pelvic radiotherapy, we are looking at gynecological cancers and the pelvis houses, the gynecological apparatus. There are other things. Why? Because with radiation, we are also giving chemotherapy for certain indications. And we know that chemotherapy affects the bone marrow. It has got a myelotoxicity. So from the radiation point of view, since we are able to see, we can sort of, I would say, avoid bone marrow. Again, the IMRT helps us and we can spare the bone marrow from our point of view so that the toxicity of the chemo and the radiation doesn't add up. Again, just to show you some pictures with respect to the IMRT, with which, now if you can appreciate, this is the bone marrow of the iliac blade with which we can spare the radiation. The dose is just conformed to this green cloud that you can see, and we can spare the iliac blade bone marrow with sort of regards to this type of radiation therapy technique. Now again, to prove this point, we need to be objective. So we have got the WBC, that is the white blood cell toxicity with respect to leukopenia, and the IMRT, as we can see, has got a lesser toxicity compared to the conventional radiotherapy technique. All right, but the IMRT, sorry, the IMRT, you need to be very sort of, you need to have a learning curve. There is an increased expenditure. You need to have a manpower. You need to have the person power. The target delineation needs to be very exact because IMRT has got a very sharp dose gradient. There is an increased integral dose. This concept or this worry is always there with respect to every sort of physician that can radiation give rise to secondary cancers. Yes, it can, but it has been proven now for the past 50 to 60 years that it is not much to worry in cases where there are pediatric tumors. I'm just speaking with respect to that. Yes, there are chances of second cancers if the childling sort of grows up into an adult. But with respect to adults, the chances of second cancers are very, very less. So we need to sort of grow over that feeling that radiation can induce a second cancer and it should not be given. That's not how it is. All right, this is the second slide. I think it's self-explanatory, and I've said that yes, there was a concern with regards to the second cancer. However, in our studies for the past 35 years now with IMRT, we haven't found anything which sort of scares us from using this technique. All right, what next? So IMRT can then further be improved with the image guidance option. Now, as I told you, these two arms have come up on this linear accelerator, which is a CT scan on the machine. Now, what's the idea is that if we are doing a CT-based planning, for example, there might be some sort of a positional error because in the planning itself. And to correct that positional error, to see that, we got a CT scanner on the machine itself, and with which we can see that error and rectify it accordingly. Right, so it is the use of real-time imaging. It can be used to improve the setup accuracy. It also manages the internal organ motion, which you can see, and it can adapt to the treatment, to the changes in patient's anatomy and or tumor response. So why this thought process? Because the fields are large, the accurate setup is essential due to the proximity of normal tissues. Again, all the things, again, this basic principle, the tumor needs to get the maximum dose, the normal tissues need to get the minimum dose. Organ motion, especially in cases of cervix where there is movement of the rectum, the bladder, we can also use this and accordingly sort of change our margins. If we are having a good IGRT system on our machine, we can reduce the margins and so forth, we can reduce the side effects. Also, there is a concept of dynamic adaptive radiotherapy. See, surgery is just a one-time sort of a thing that we do, one-time procedure. Radiation is fractionated. It is given over a period of time. Now, during the period of time, if we are finding any sort of tumor change, the tumor size is regressing, if there is a tumor motion, we can also adapt the radiotherapy in which we can replan during the radiation and accordingly save the normal tissue which has started coming inside the initial tumor volume. So, if a cervix is compressing the bladder, a cervical malignancy that is, and if reduces during the radiation, that is during the radiation, we can adjust our fields, we can do a replan. So there is always a concept of dynamic adaptation with respect to the tumor. Right, so this is just an example to show that the disease does regress. So the GTV here, if you can see the arrow cursor, it represents the gross tumor volume. And if you can see, it's in the pink sort of contour that we do. So here we are contouring everything, the disease that we wish to treat and the areas that we don't want to treat. And now after 30 gray, that is the dose that we are giving, after some time the tumor shows regression. So I might as well replan for this patient so as to reduce the toxicity. Now you can see the bowel, which is in the magenta color, has started coming inside. So if I'm going ahead with the same plan, I would be hurting the bowel. So once we are seeing this on the machine, we can sort of change our plan and sort of, again, the basic intent to reduce the side effects. All right. Now we've got the plan of the day as well. Depending upon the bladder movement, we can have different plans based upon the bladder position. So that is known as the plan of the day. And midway, as I said, we can do anytime whenever we want to. All right. Brachytherapy. Brachytherapy, as I said earlier, the sources have to be placed near, that is in the cavity of the tumor, interstitial inside the tumor, right? Intraluminal, as in the case of esophageal or cholangiocarcinomas, where we place inside the lumen. In gynecological cancers, brachytherapy probably was the forerunner compared to external beam radiotherapy. Why? Because radium was sort of, sorry, someone raised a hand. Someone has a question.
They want to explain the point A and point B.
All right, that I'm coming to.
Yes, that's why I'm not disturbing.
All right.
Yeah.
All right. So let questions be at the end. No issues.
Yes, sir.
All right. Okay. So brachytherapy for cervical cancers was the forerunner in which the radium was sort of tried out. It had good results, however, with a lot of toxicity because there was no control over the dose rate. That needs to be understood. All right, so this is how the brachytherapy looks like. There is a central cylinder with two sort of colpostats that we place in the fornices. So this gives a pear-shaped a picture, which is the ideal way to do it. Now, there are two ways of brachytherapy. That is, with respect to the brachytherapy, there's a low dose rate in which we need to keep the patient in the ward for some time. Generally, it is 27 to 38 hours. And the high dose rate, in which the dose rate is so high with respect to the isotope that we can get away with the treatment in 5 to 10 minutes. All right, so point A and point B. With respect to the Manchester system, is where the uterine artery crosses the ureter, and that is the point B, I'm sorry, and point A is 2 centimeter, where we are defining it with respect to the flange. Now, this is a geometrical concept that in which we sort of define wherever the tandem, the central tandem is going. We take a 2 centimeter superior, we move 2 centimeter superior and 2 centimeter lateral, that represents the paracolpus, that is the paracolpus near the vaginal tissue, which can sort of tolerate the high dose envelope. And point B is just 3 centimeters away from that, which is where the uterine artery crosses the ureter. So that is the point where we can have the maximum tolerance with respect to the dose. However, as we go from point A to point B, there is a dose fall off. Therefore, we need to sort of know that we cannot go beyond a certain dose of the point B. I hope I'm clear. If there's any doubt, kindly let me know.
Yes, sir. We'll take questions.
So point A. All right. Okay. All right. So these are the different types of systems that we had: Paris, Stockholm, Manchester. However, in the recent times, there is a simple generic term which is used, which is the computer system, which is using all the computerized iterations, and that is generally used for the high dose rate brachytherapy. So since I worked in Tata, we used to have a preloaded and an afterloaded manual thing. The low dose rate brachytherapy isotope is the cesium 157. For the high dose rate, it is iridium 192. I myself have placed the cesium tubes, taking the due precautions inside the applicators. That was an afterloaded. It is hazardous. It is sort of now not recommended. So now there is a preloaded system in which the machine inserts with a sort of a pneumatic, electro-pneumatic system, inserts the source inside that particular position. So there is always one source in that brachy machine. Either it's a low dose rate or a high dose rate. And it gets inserted into that particular point. It gives off the radiation dose, comes to the point 2, comes to the point 3. So there are designated points. The idea is to get a pear-shaped dose, as I said, to achieve a very good dose to the paracolpus and the parametry. All right, so these are just some of the pictures. Now you can see clearly the central tandem. We are putting 2 ovoids in the cervix. We do it under short sedation in the operation theater. It's a very simple sort of a procedure. And again, someone raised a hand. Can we take the question or at the end?
So that person wants the previous slides. The comparison slide. The comparison slide, they want to explain again.
This one?
Previous one. The table slide, sir.
This one?
The previous operation.
This is the table slide. Can you see?
So table slide. Yes, sir. Yes, now we can see.
This one.
Yes.
Right. If you want, I can email this presentation to you. There's no problem with
that.
Sure. Right. Okay.
They want to explain this slide again, sir.
All right. All these techniques I've just put up as an example. These are all the cases of low dose rate, in which, as you can see, that the duration is 5 to 7 days, 48 hours, 72 hours. I haven't put up the HDR thing, which is the high dose rate, in which, again, the system remains the same, but because of the radioisotope, it is generally given in 5 to 10 minutes. Trust me, the entire dose. But then the dose has to be adjusted. In a low dose, I'll come to that in when we are treating. I'll tell you the doses. In the low dose rate, we are giving around about 25 to 27 gray as a single session, or sometimes divided sessions also, depending upon the patient's convenience. But in the high dose rate, we are giving 2 or 3 sessions at a week's interval. All right?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
All right, so this is how the dose looks like. These are the older pictures in which we are getting the 100% dose. You can see the 100% ISO dose. I hope everyone can see that. So anything inside dose is close to 200%. Now, why are we giving such a high dose? Because we know that there is a great radio tolerance of the vaginal and the external os. So we are safe to give that. Otherwise, we won't be able to give that. Otherwise, we'll be causing a lot of necrosis. So we know that the radio tolerance of these tissues is quite high, right? That is how it is. The other advantage of brachytherapy is that with external, even though IMRT can give us good distributions, we cannot go beyond a certain dose because then it would affect the bladder and the rectum. With brachytherapy, with the inverse square law, we can get very high dose gradients within a very short sort of distance from the disease itself. These are the example of interstitial implantation. So in a case of cancer cervix, case of cancer vagina, where the geometry is not sort of suitable for an intracavitary sort of implantation, we can also employ interstitial implantation, in which we are inserting the needles. And through the needles, as you can see, we can achieve a dose. This on the right side, if you can see, is the dose. The bladder needs to be catheterized. The interstitial implantation generally takes 3 to 4 days. So the procedure, once it's done, the patient stays in the hospital for 3 to 4 days. There are indications with respect to the anatomy. And if the anatomy sort of is not feasible for the intracavitary, then we employ the interstitial implantation. All right. So these slides are just run through the staging which we need to do for every cancer and also for gynecological cancer. Now the FIGO staging doesn't take into account the lymph nodal sort of aspect, but the TNM staging does. And as you can see in uterine cervix also, they've started putting the paralytic lymph nodes, which earlier they weren't doing. So CA cervix was actually a surgically staged disease from the FIGO point of view, which I think you people are also following. But now there is a concept of doing a TNM staging, which involves the tumor node and the metastasis. So it can, both the systems are complementary. It's not that one is to replace the other, but we need to use both of them. So I'll just skip these slides. We all know these slides. We can sort of run through. We can find these things on the FIGO website as well.
Yes, sir.
All right, the ovarian slide, it's more extensive, as we all know. 1A, 1B, 1C. All right. Now I'll straight away jump to the CA cervix. So we, as radiation oncologists, generally divide it as early cervix, 1A, 1A1, 1A2, 1B1, 1B2, 2A1, 2A2. For us, as per the evidence that we see, a bulky 1B2, that is 4 centimeter more, confined to the uterus and the cervix, we would always say that giving radiation along plus minus chemo would be better than surgery. So starting off with stage 1A1, extrafascial hysterectomy is potentially curative. For stage 1B1, radical hysterectomy with resection of the parametry and dissection of the pelvic lymph nodes, paralytic lymph nodes should be examined. And if the parametrial extension that the surgeon finds out intraoperatively, most gynecologists sort of abort the hysterectomy and proceed to the pelvic radiotherapy. So in case of 1B1 till 1B1, as per the studies, if the patients have the following risk factors after surgery, that is greater than 1/3 cervical stroma, invasion, capillary lymphatic space, invasion and large clinical tumor diameter, the patients will definitely benefit from adjuvant radiotherapy. And just to add on to this, the lymph nodal metastasis, then you need to do chemoradiotherapy, right? So randomized trials have been done post-surgery in which surgery followed by nothing versus surgery followed by radiation for these factors showed an advantage for radiotherapy for the survival endpoints. Similarly, where in addition to these factors, if there was a lymph node positivity in the pelvis, giving chemoradiotherapy was a better option. And these are just the results. Now, the idea with respect to radiation earlier on was with respect to toxicity. That thing has resolved. Things have become better with respect to the toxicity. So if you can read this yellow sort of font, which says improvement in the overall survival. As oncologists, either surgical, medical, or radiation, the hardest endpoint for us is the overall survival. All right. So 1B, 2, 2A, now there is a sort of a debate on this, but as per the radiation oncology and the medical oncology community, giving chemo radiotherapy is always a better option compared to radiation alone, especially 1B, 2, till 4A, we can go ahead till the stage 4A. Chemo radiotherapy is always preferred. And there were quite a few randomized trials, and then there is a concept of meta-analysis which sort of gets the gist of the randomized trial. This is the trial which shows that adding cisplatin 5-FU. Now 5-FU turned out to be toxic, so right now what is being employed world over is to give platinum, that is cisplatin, along with radiotherapy, with the external beam radiotherapy, starting from, see, if we see the RTOG trial, it was from 1B2. Some people have also tried from 1A2 as well, but yes, that is debatable. So anything for me, 1B2, 2A cervix, we give chemo radiotherapy. That is how we would think of. Yes, if the gynecologist, Dr. Yogesh, can operate on 1B2, and if the post-operative features, the chances are that the patient would require post-radiotherapy, at least, if not chemotherapy, because there would be certain adverse features which are going to come up on the histopathology slide. Again, I'm skipping slide, but the gist is that for 1B2, the radiation oncologist would say that if the patient is undergoing surgery, even though we're getting the tissue picture, but the risk factors are quite, the chances are quite high that we'll find those risk factors and then we'll have to do some sort of adjuvant therapy for that patient. All right. Couple of people have also tried chemotherapy before surgery so as to see whether what response we get. Now, there have been two trials, one done in Italy and one done in India at Tata Memorial, in which they have compared neoadjuvant chemotherapy, that is before surgery, versus chemoradiation. And both of the trials, in humility, I should say that chemoradiation was better than chemo followed by surgery. Both these trials have sort of given these results. Again, just to repeat my point that chemo radiation still remains the key. Squamous CA cervix again is a very radiosensitive. Why radiation and radiation oncologist brags about this thing? Because the squamous CA cervix is a radiosensitive pathology. The areas have got great radio tolerance. We've got good techniques. So all these make us more confident. The results have improved. The quality of life still remains very well now with the advent of modern techniques. All right. Now there is a dilemma which happens when there are para-aortic lymph nodes. Now the recent FIGO, again, it is subject to question, but the latest gives the para-aortic lymph nodes now as regional lymph nodes for CA cervix, if you'll go through FIGO 2 2018, and which then allows the treating physician, I wouldn't say surgery versus radiation, to treat the patient on a curative basis. That is, if the disease is not metastatic, then we can treat the patient on a curative basis. Either if the local stage of cervix is 1B1, and if there are para-aortic lymph nodes which are examined, and if the oncosurgeon finds it to be positive on frozen section, he or she can then do the para-aortic lymph nodal dissection. That is the RPLND, retroperitoneal lymph node dissection. But that is how things have changed with respect to the staging of cancer cervix. All right. Again, coming back to the external followed by brachy. So the idea of giving, in a definitive case for radiation, we give, if we find a lymph node which is there on imaging, we give a high dose. Otherwise, we are prophylactically treating the pelvic lymph nodes. Uh, with the primary to a certain dose, which is generally to the tune of 45 to 50 gray. Along with that, as you can see in the slide, if we found that there is a risk to the paratic lymph nodes, either if we find a paratic lymph node which is positive or if there are chances, especially in 3B, then we'll give a prophylactic dose to the paratic lymph node. And these are the organs at risk. Again, the normal tissues, the normal organs that we need to protect and sort of save from radiation. Okay, couple of dose prescriptions. As I said, 1A1. Now, for 1A1, if we are not doing surgery, we can do 65 to 75 gray to the point A, the question to the point A. 1A, from starting from 1A2, if I'm doing a definitive therapy, I have to give external beam radiotherapy followed by the intracavitary radiotherapy. 1B1, more or less the dose remains the same, but the intracavitary dose increases. Adjuvant radiotherapy, the high risk group, if the parameter margin is positive, and external beam radiotherapy followed by brachytherapy. Now this brachytherapy would only be not be an intracervical or intracavitary, it would just be an intravaginal brachytherapy, which is given as two or three sessions to a certain dose from the vaginal mucosal surface so as to prevent the vaginal recurrence. Again, all these things sort of have shown that we are trying to get a local control either after surgery or as a definitive case and to improve the overall survival. All right, some other dose prescriptions. As I said, external beam radiotherapy 50 gray. However, with the IMRT, we are now going up to 55 gray. Again, the intracavitary dose to the point A. Now, this is as per the low dose rate. If I'm giving a single session or two sessions, if I'm doing it in the HDR, that is the high dose rate, we have to convert with respect to dose, and we tend to give it in two or three sessions. The chemotherapy generally runs along every sort of three weekly or every weekly. And these are the 5-year survivals that we are getting with respect to the stages. This is slightly older data now that the survivals are close to 90 to 95%, especially for 1B, 2 to 2B. All right, coming on to endometrial carcinoma, generally the surgery remains the mainstay because it tells about the histopathological picture. However, there are certain cases where the patient is medically inoperable, that is the patient can't undergo surgery. There also radiation has given very good 5-year disease survival rates. This is proven in the literature. I have my own personal experience with a couple of patients where the patient was medically unfit and there are good survival rates with a decent quality of life. Adjuvant radiation therapy, the endometrial carcinoma again is divided into 1A, 1B, 1C with regards to grade. I always check the table because it's confusing with respect to observation versus intravaginal versus external beam radiotherapy. There are a couple of studies which have been done on gynecology group as well as on the PORTEC trial. I'll skip those slides because they're a bit, this is how I think of when I see an endometrial CA. 1A, that is less than half, and it's a grade 1, we do observation. If it's grade 3, we can still opt for observation or intravaginal brachy. This is as per the GOG group, that is from the American studies, that you should do pelvic XRT, but this has been sort of this has been taken over by the PORTEC 3 trial. So even doing an intravaginal brachytherapy, why? Because post endometrial carcinoma, there is a lot of lymph node dissection that has been done. You have to do a paratic lymph node dissection. Gynecologists tend to do a sentinel lymph node from the paratic so as to reduce the morbidity, but the standard still remains paratic lymph node dissection. 1B, now this is 1B and 1C. The latest endometrium has now just become B, that is more than 50%. But for guiding part, we will still use that in which, again, for grade 2, intravaginal brachy plus pelvic RT. And for grade 3 also, we're using intravaginal brachy plus pelvic external beam RT. XRT means the external RT. So it is well proven that giving post-operative adjuvant radiation, there were a couple of studies which showed no significant reduction. Then came the PORTEC trial. Again, the radiation induced the locoregional recurrence with respect to the external beam radiotherapy, with respect to low risk and low intermediate risk endometrial carcinoma. The gynecology group, I'm just skipping it for the sake of time. The cancer recurrence was low. However, with respect to brachytherapy, there was decrease in the locoregional recurrence, and also with respect to disease-specific survival. Right? And again, earlier it used to be done on a low dose rate basis. Now we can do it on a high dose rate basis, which is simple post-surgery that the patient has to come once a week for the HDR session. And the treatment generally lasts from 15 minutes to 30 minutes. That is how it is. So as I said, the HDR technique is quite OPD friendly or patient friendly because the treatment is actually done on an OPD basis. The patient doesn't need to be sort of admitted. Generally, we are giving it over 3 weekly doses of 5 gray. Sometimes we increase the dose to 6 to 6.5 gray. And when given without the external beam radiotherapy, we are giving 7 to 7.5 gray. So if we are giving it with the external beam radiotherapy, we tend to give it, some people give it over 2 sessions depending upon the logistics. Some give it on 3 sessions. If we are doing it without the external beam radiotherapy, as for example for 1A, 1B endometrial grade 1 to 2, we're there, we need to slightly increase the dose to so as to increase the vaginal dose. All right, I'm going to skip this slide. All right, stage 3, stage 4 endometrial cancer. There is a lot of, I would say, debate. However, whole abdominal radiation therapy, considering the parietic lymph nodal involvement, earlier it was attempted and it was sort of compared on a GOG 122 study, a randomized trial comparing the whole abdominal radiation, comparing it to chemo. The chemo was found to be better. Again, the technique, the whole abdominal radiation was done in those times where the technology was not that efficient. Things have changed. However, for stage 3, stage 4, are the concept, the pragmatic view is that you need to get the parietic nodes negative and then from the chemo, and if the surgery is feasible, the patient then goes for surgery and then you restage accordingly. So first you stage the disease, you give chemotherapy, and if feasible, you do surgery as per if the disease has sort of regressed, and then you restage it and then treat it accordingly. There are other variants of endometrial CA, like the papillary serous CA, which has got a propensity for local and distant recurrence. Again, this warrants that post. Now, this is a case where post-surgery, you need to do both chemo as well as radiation. The malignant mixed Müllerian tumor carcinosarcoma also requires the same therapy, and the pelvic radiotherapy along with chemo is required. Why? Now this is a serious thought. The surgeon operates. Now, it's a simple thing which has been proven. The blood vessels are sort of disturbed on a layman basis. So the chemotherapy is given through an IV or through a chemo port. Now, the hypoxic regions in the tumor and the operative bed are unreachable by the chemotherapy. So you tend to find a local recurrence if you give just the chemotherapy post a surgery for either of these malignancies. Why? Because the local tissue was unamenable and was not getting the chemotherapy bioavailability. Radiation has got no such problems. That is, radiation can reach anywhere that we wish to focus on to, and can kill the hypoxic cells in the tumor and the operative bed. So this needs to be understood that post-surgery, even though the disease has got a propensity for distant recurrence, if you give chemo, the chances are that the disease will come back locally. And since the local environment is not disease-friendly, it can then again present as a distant failure. I hope I'm clear. All right, okay, next slide. Vaginal malignancies, generally surgery is the way to go, partial or total vaginectomy followed by post-operative radiotherapy. Radiotherapy plus cisplatin, again, if we are finding it in stage 2 and more. And radiotherapy, again, is to given to the field similar to the cervical malignancy to the dose of 45 to 50 gray, or interstitial brachytherapy if it is less than stage 2. Vulvar cancers, the mainstay of treatment remains surgery. The idea is to reduce the risk of the locoregional failure, and radiation can be attempted where the vulvar cancer is sort of extending into the urethra, or there is an anal extension where the patient doesn't wish for the same. A good quality of life with an intent radical, I would say, can be sort of given. Dose of radiation, again, 45 to 50 gray. Given to the microscopic disease where the disease can go, or 60 to 64 gray where the disease is evident, where it's gross disease. And post-operative radiotherapy given after surgery, if the margins are clear. There are two things: if the margins are clear and if the nodes are clear, Then radiation, depending upon the stage on the surgery, if it is stage 2 or more post-surgery, then you still have to give radiation. If the nodes are positive, you still have to give radiotherapy in spite of the clear margins. For ovarian cancer, so this is a blind spot for radiation, because whole abdominal radiation, generally when we tend to find the peritoneal deposits and the omental caking, whole abdominal radiation has been tried, but it hasn't given us much success. And especially because ovarian cancer responds very well to non-success, I would say. Now, palliative radiotherapy, very important. This, what we were discussing, was all about curative radiotherapy, especially for hemostatic radiotherapy, or where the patient is medically inoperable. We can give hemostatic radiotherapy. It really works, helps. The neoangiogenesis associated with the disease tends to sort of stop, and it also gives us tumor control with respect to that. Choriocarcinoma, radiation is reserved only for metastasis to CNS, spinal cord, or liver, again with respect to the palliative. The breast malignancy is estrogen progesterone receptor positive, and the disease is aggressive. There, the patient is made postmenopausal and then started on an aromatase inhibitor. There also radiation can be done, and the term is radiation oophorectomy, where we are deliberately sort of ablating the ovaries. The word is ablation, so that the source of estrogens is sort of taken off or withered off. All right. So that concludes my presentation. Thank you so much. Hello. Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Sir,
all right.
All the questions are answered, sir, in the chat box in your presentation.
All right. Thank
yes,
you.
Yes, sir. Thank
and
you.
Still,
sir.
Any question? Any doubt?
Sir, no, not now in the chat box. You have answered all the questions, sir, in the.
All right. Presentation. I hope I haven't put people to sleep.
No, sir. There are 120 people already hearing you, sir. Thank you so much for your valuable time, sir. Yes, sir. Okay.
Thank you for having me here. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Yes.
Thank you.